But little I know about him, he's a Northwest and World illustrator and photographer. He's been a wildlife biologist for more than 20 years. He's worked in Alaska and all over the world. He's taken pictures in the tropics and everywhere, Oregon coast, everywhere. He currently lives in Toledo, and with that, I'll let him come up and say some more.
Well, I can tell from those introductions we have a fun group here tonight. So, I also paint birds. Yes, and not just on my pants. So, I did work seasonally as a biologist for about 20 years, but now I'm doing wildlife illustration full time. Okay, and interestingly, and related to this program, I'm doing a very large project of 65 interpretive panels. Those are the signage that you see on the side of the road. And these are going to go on state parks all up and down the coast here. So you will not be able to avoid seeing my paintings, even if you try. Okay? And I do have, I'm starting on this project, and I have a few of the paintings in this program. Okay? I did take all the pictures in the program. A lot of them are from Alaska, where you can get closer to the seabirds, because I spent several summers actually living on uninhabited islands with just birds. And I was able to get quite close to them. Here, they're less accessible, so you can't get as close for these type of photographs. But I'm going to cover a bunch of common species that are found on the Oregon coast here, okay? And feel free to interrupt me if you want. I don't mind. Okay. All right, this is one of my paintings here, and I'm going to refer back to this painting throughout the program because it shows all the species on the Oregon coast, okay, and where they nest. So when I introduce each new bird, I'll go back to this graphic and show you where they tend to nest on an offshore rock or island. Okay. All right, this is one of the paintings for this series I'm doing for the Oregon coast. So basically I do an acrylic painting, and then this will have the text added to it. And this particular image has a map of Oregon on the side right here that shows where all the seabird nesting colonies are. This one is going at, who can identify that lighthouse? Come on, somebody's got a guess.
It looks like a sea duck.
Okay, no.
Yakina?
I am doing, what was that?
That's haystack, isn't that Yakina?
Yaquina,
excuse me.
That is Cape Mears.
Cape Mears.
The shortest lighthouse on the coast. Okay, I am doing one for Hasita Head, but I haven't got to that one yet. That does look fairly similar. And these are common murres in the foreground.
How big will the, is that the size they'll be, the signs?
Most of them are 18 by 24. Okay. I'm sorry, 24 by 36. Yeah, 24 by 36 is the standard size. Some of them be quite a bit larger than that. Okay. This particular image depicts seabirds in the winter, and it describes on this panel how they survive all those winter storms and make it through to the next breeding season. And this shows some of these species we're going to look at today in their winter plumage. Most people don't see them like this because they're out at sea, out near the shelf break when they look like this. You know, that's that right there, that's a puffin. It doesn't look like the puffins you usually see depicted.
Okay. Pigeon guillemots.
What?
Pigeon guillemots?
No, no pigeon guillemots on here. These are all winter plumage puffins and one murre. But they do look like pigeon guillemots that type of year because they're just all dark. So. Okay. All right, so this is an example of how I do these paintings. This is my rough sketch that I start with. You can see it's fairly loose. Whoops. Let me go back. Am I going to have to walk over here and do this? There you go. So that's the painting on my drafting table there. And you can see this one's quite large. I couldn't even fit it on there, so it's kind of wrapping around onto the wall there. And here we go. This is the final painting. And it shows a number of different species in their breeding plumage as they appear on the colony. And then this is a finished panel here. Okay, so it has my artwork on it and then a bunch of text, you know, and we're covering a variety of topics all related to seabirds on these panels. Okay, so the first species we're going to look at is common murre. Okay, who's heard of those? Okay, they sound like... And it's pronounced murre, not Muir, as in John Muir. But because more than 50% of the people out there say Muir. And I say, who, John Muir? No, it's just murre, common murre. They don't build a nest. They just nest right on the rocks. You see, this is a very dense nesting colony at Yaquina Head that has over 30,000 birds on it. Yeah, well, start counting. There are a lot right there. And again, they just lay their egg right on the rock, no nest at all. Okay, so this species you can see has a fairly wide range, and it does occur over in the Atlantic as well. And there's a painting I did of the species. This depicts a chick being fed right here. This parent is bringing in this case, a squid for that chick. And then here is the colony below, and the pink is all guano. They actually have quite a brightly colored inside to their mouth there. This species feeds on small fish. Around here, it would be a lot of herring, anchovies, some cod, and whatever they can catch, but mostly densely schooling fish. Here's a close-up of two common murres, beautiful birds. And when you're out at an area where you can see common murres, the Yaquina Head is a really terrific place. You can see them at Aceta Head as well. Usually if you stand there for a while, someone will come up and say, look at all the penguins! So you can see they are. They do have a very similar color pattern, but you see one of the differences illustrated in this photograph. Flight! Okay. Here's one coming in at us about to land. Now, they're not particularly elegant flyers. They have a very heavy body compared to the size of their wings. So they're not that graceful in the air, and they have crash landings typically. Oh, that one, you know, that one's looking like it's doing pretty well on its landing there. Let's get some style points. But a lot of times they just crash right into the other birds and there's a big ruckus. Yeah, now that's a more awkward landing there. It looks like he's trying to wedge his way in and get to that egg. And then there's this issue. I don't know if everyone can see that, but sometimes it just, life isn't great as a murre in those densely packed colonies. Okay. I mentioned that they don't build a nest, right? They just lay that egg right on the rocks there. And in those densely packed colonies, it's very useful to have a unique looking egg. Now look at these, no two are alike. They're like fingerprints. You have this one almost pure white, and then you have almost a blue, and then a variety of splotches on these eggs.
Plus, yep. Plus the shape less likely to roll.
I'm over. Getting to that! You trying to get ahead of me here? Do your own presentation.
Does that particular hen always lay the same egg, or does every egg different?
The eggs are different each year, but the same individual, I've noticed from going back in successive years, has a similar looking egg. Mm. So like this one right here, that'll give a nice richly colored egg the next year as well. So, as we heard a little bit about, the shape of the egg here is conducive to rolling in a circle. You see how they're kind of pointed? So this pointed end here stays in the middle if this is bumped. So that just rolls around a circle with that narrower end staying in the middle. Okay.
How did you come by all those eggs?
I'm telling you, they're delicious. Yeah, that's a great question, actually, because these were all collected on the Pribilof Islands where there are Arctic fox. So the Arctic fox ate all these eggs, and you can't see it too well in these pictures, but the interior of the egg has been sucked out by a fox. And then they just leave these eggs laying around on the island, and I collected them. Okay, for that, for the picture. Okay. Oh, this illustration here just shows how they hold the egg, usually on their feet like a penguin. Okay, because their feet are a lot warmer than that cold stone below, so that helps keep them warm. And there's the cute little chick! Now, one thing I want to point out about this guy, this chick's only a few days old, you understand. But look how big those feet are! So it spends the next couple weeks growing into those feet. I got more pictures as they get older coming up here. Okay, so at this time, the parents are bringing back fish to feed that chick, and that the MERS always bring back just one fish. Okay, in a minute we'll see the puffins. They got a whole bill full of fish flopping around. The MER only brings back one. That's a capelin it's got there. Very highly nutritious fish. There's that cute little chick again, trying to grow into those feet. Okay, yep, there is a food delivery. Look at those little wings. Okay, this one's about a week old now. Okay, when this one's 2 weeks to 3 weeks old. And you can see it doesn't have its flight feathers in yet. It does have a lot of contour feathers to keep it warm, replacing the down. At this age, the chicks jump off the cliff. Now, they can't fly. They jump and they flutter those little wings to try to break the fall a little bit, and then they crash onto the rocks and bounce. Or, you know, if they happen to be above the ocean, they fall into the ocean. But it's really a remarkable thing and unique to the MERS. Well, let me tell you about this. Well, the way this whole thing works is usually on a moonlit night, particularly when the tide is high, the fathers get down below the colony in the ocean and call up to the chick. Okay, but the chicks are hesitant to take that plunge, as you could understand. Often it's a very long drop, and they don't just respond immediately when dad's calling. No, no. They gotta build up to it, and usually there's a whole bunch of dads, and it's always the dad, by the way, calling up to the colony. And like a whole bunch of excitement builds, and the chick sounds like this. And then you have like 100 of these. You just get more and more, and then one jumps, and then the floodgates are open, and they all just start jumping. So it's quite a dramatic affair, and I do have some pictures of that scene coming up here. There's a good portrait of that. I call them jumplings. Instead of fledglings. Yeah, you've heard that term? Oh good, I thought I made it up. Okay, here we are. We have all these chicks on the edge here. Here's mom, you know, the dad's down in the water. And these chicks are like, I don't know about this whole thing. And then, let's see. Yep, here they go, they're starting to jump. And there's one in flight. And it's hard to get a picture of this because it happens at night. Okay, that was pretty early in that cycle. Whoops, okay, there's one. These ones did jump and land on a rocky area, and then there was a beach, and they just, again, they can't fly. You see how stubby that wing is? They just hop their way down. Oh, here dad said, what are you doing? Come on, let's go out to the ocean. and it's helping that chick. Okay, the gulls do gather to try to feed on these chicks, okay? And what I did, I actually, when I was on this particular island, I had one of these laser pointers and I zapped the gull like that. I didn't do it too much, but you understand. I'm rooting for the mer, okay? Yeah. But it's interesting because here the gull has got that little chick, but they fight pretty well, and about 50% would escape. See? That one escaped, and I didn't even interfere with that one. Okay, I might, but they do escape. Finally, they're in the water after all that, and then they get wiped out in the waves. So it's a tough life for a mer chick. Now here it is with dad going out to sea, and the father will feed that chick for another 2 to 3 weeks, okay? Out in the ocean. These chicks are really hard to control. I've done a number of studies with MERS, and there's a chick trying to get out of my hands. They're real hard to keep a handle on. All right, so I don't know if you can even see in this picture what's going on. Can you? Okay, there's a human up here. You see this little thing? You see that head? Okay, this is a head right here. Yeah, with a hood on. And then you see this super long pole? That's how we catch them. There's a slip knot on the end of that super long pole for catching the mer. Okay, there you see the slip knot. And that pole is going off, woo, way over like that. And then you very slowly try to get it around that bird's head. Let's see here. Okay, this is a success. I got that around there. And then you just gently pull it and it closes. See, there it is. And then you have someone nearby that you kind of let the bird fly over to the other person while controlling it with that pole. I think I mentioned I paint birds for a living. Actually, painting them was a little bit messy, so we went to this tag system. That's a piece of Teflon tape on the head so that we know which MERS we have our devices on, because we have to recapture them, okay, to get that data from them. This one's named Bugs. Okay, so this is a time depth recorder. It records the length of time that the birds are underwater foraging and how deep they're going, so we can get a profile of their diving behavior and see how hard they're working to forage and at what depths and so forth. And we also put GPS tags on them so we can see where they're going, which areas of the ocean they're utilizing to capture food. Okay, this is a scene up at Yaquina Head, and looks like these birds are flying off. Anyone know about this issue that's happening up there?
Yes.
Yeah, the bald eagles are coming in large numbers and scaring all the MERS off of their nesting ledges. And they've, even though there's maybe 40,000 MERS that congregate there, there's virtually no nesting success. And this is even more true all the way north of Newport. There used to be thousands and thousands of MERS nesting up there. Now there's virtually no nesting success, all because of these bad boys. They look good on a quarter, though. Okay, here you can see the eagle flies in. Here it's taking an adult MER. Whoops. Okay. Well, you can see that one has a couple chicks it's flying off with. But the real problem with these eagles is when they scare the MERS off of the top of the rock, the gulls come in. You see, I don't know if you can see, there's hundreds of tiny eggs on here, and the gulls just feast on those. Okay, so it's a big issue. As you, many of you probably know, bald eagles used to be a lot more scarce around here. Their populations have gone up, and they're now causing these problems with MERS and other seabirds. Okay, I go up to Alaska each summer and teach a seabird youth camp. And this last summer we did photography. This was taken by one of the kids up there, this guy. So a pretty nice photo for a kid. Okay, we're going to look at tufted puffin next. And let me just let you know that I'm not going to talk this long about each species. It's just the myrrh and the puffin I'm featuring tonight, and then we'll move through the other ones quite quickly. Yep.
How deep do they dive? How long do they stay down there?
Myrrhs dive for, they'll dive, let me think about that. It's 300 feet. It's a remarkable figure, and every time I give a presentation or tell someone, I have to think, can that be? And yes, it is. The deepest diving bird is the emperor penguin, which dives over 1,000 feet deep. Really remarkable. As for the time, I think it's about, I don't have that statistic, I think it's about 6 minutes that they can dive for. Okay, so unlike the common myrrh, the tufted puffin digs a burrow to lay its egg in. And that egg is round because it can roll around all in there all at once. It's not going to fall out of the burrow. The burrows are up to 3 feet deep. And oftentimes they dig that burrow underneath a clump of grass, and the roots provide some structure for the entrance of the burrow. Check this out. There's a colony I actually slept under. My tent was right under this colony up on an island in Alaska. Okay, you can see here the range. The red is the breeding range, and they their range extends down to the Farallon Islands. Okay, and up to the Arctic Sea.
Can you do their call too?
Oh, sure. You ready for this?
Oh, yeah.
Sorry. That's it. They're not the most vocal. Maybe an occasional. I don't know. That was a little bit different, but they only vocalize from inside the burrow. So that one's shaking. It's got some, its tufts sticking up in the air there. They only have those tufts during the breeding season, and they're funny looking birds. They're like they're called the clowns of the sea sometimes, and another nickname is sea parrot. You know, they have that kind of a parrot-like beak, but they're very social on the rocks. Interacting with each other. Here you can see, I mentioned earlier, they'll bring back whole beakfuls of fish. The record is I think 63 fish one brought back. That was a lucky chick, I must say. These are little larval fish that this one has. Whoops. This is a great picture, and it's been stolen from me all over the internet. So that's one of my better flight shots. It's really hard to get a shot of a puffin in flight like that. A lot of people have. A little trouble with my, okay, so some people wonder, how do they get so many fish in their beak? You know, you catch a fish, how do you catch another one when you got a fish in your beak? It's not that, it's pretty difficult. But if you look closely here, you can see on the top of the mouth, they have these real sharp spines that point back, so they can catch one fish and they scoot it to the back of the mouth with the tongue, and those spines sink in. And then the beak is actually flexible so that end of the beak can open while it's holding the fish here. And it keeps catching with that, just the end of the beak, and then sticking them on those spines. Okay? Now the penguins one up the puffin. Myrrhs have these too. Penguins actually have spikes on the mouth, the roof of the mouth, and on the tongue. So you look at a penguin's tongue, it's got those same spikes in both places. Well, this one's bringing back some feathers for the nest, okay? They don't build a real elaborate nest. They bring in some feathers and plants and just kind of toss them around at the end of the burrow. This one's got a big mouthful of fish for you. Now here's their cute chick, very fluffy. Its feet aren't as big as the mer, if you notice. But that one's just a few days old. And I have a series of shots. Well, that one just pooped on me. And yeah, here we're gonna, I just have a few shots showing the chick as it grows up. This one's getting the contour feathers. It's losing this down and getting these waterproof contour feathers growing in. They look a little awkward at this stage as they have irregular tufts sticking off here and there. Okay, this is what the chick looks like when it leaves the burrow. Unlike the mer, this is the same size as the adult when it leaves the burrow, and they're totally unaccompanied. In fact, the parents just stop feeding them, and eventually the chick wanders out and looks around, where's my food? I better go find my own. And then they just flutter down into the water from there. Whoops. Huh, a little bit tricky here with the remote. Okay, I just have a few more shots. You know, I've been up to Alaska at least 20 times, and I never get tired of taking pictures of tufted puffins. Got the landing gear out on that one. Okay, I got a few real close-up shots of puffins, just in case you didn't think I was obsessed with them. Here you can see some very sharp nails on here, which it uses to dig out that burrow. Okay, and I mentioned I've done a number of studies with tufted puffin in which I would reach in and handle the adults, and they bite extremely hard. So usually I try to control that beak, but then they just sink those nails right into you also. So it's, your hands get really cut up working with puffins, I must say. Oh, this is an interesting thing here. You see there's a little tear in the webbing between the feet. That's actually very common. You can see this skin is really quite thin. Oh yeah, here we are, more close-ups. You can see the pupil here is not perfectly round, it's like a scallop shape. Oh, okay, this is great too. We have here, that's the nostril, right on the edge of the beak there. And then this is called the rosette. It's a piece of flesh that when the bird opens its beak, it can stretch that way out to open that beak. Very wide indeed. Okay, this is a shot from the Oregon Coast Aquarium of actually it's a different species of puffin, but this part of the beak actually falls off. Quite dramatic. I tell people that yeah, part of the puffin's beak falls off in the fall, and they don't believe me. I finally got a picture of it.
Does that happen once a year?
Yes, once
it's
a year.
It's molting.
Yeah, it's a type of molting. It's a cartilaginous, it's the material is like it's like the rest of the beak, and it you can see this one, that part of the beak has fallen off and it's growing a new one, basically. So this is what the puffin looks like during the winter. Much different from that showy summer plumage. You don't usually see them like that. Okay. This is another shot by one of the students up there. Notice that she's even got a seabird helmet on. Okay, that's a Christmas card I did. It's the puffin tree. It's got the envelope there, and then you got that whole thing. So. Okay, the next species we're going to look at here, I don't know if you can see it too well in that picture, but it's the rhinoceros auklet, which is actually biologically a puffin, not an auklet. See that cool deal? It's got that, obviously it's named after this horny protuberance on the top of the beak. And you can see these, best place in Oregon to see these? Who knows?
Sea
lion caves, they're a local celebrity. So anyone who's come to the Oregon coast who hasn't seen a rhinoceros auklet, people always say, oh, go to the sea lion caves, they nest right in there. Okay, now we're going to look at your pigeon guillemot. This species spends a lot more time close to the shore, and they feed right in the intertidal zone. So they eat a different type of fish. See, this one's got a crescent gunwale here, a species that likes to live in amongst the rocks. See their range there. Okay, I have till 6:30, so I'm doing fine. All right, now the pigeon guillemot, you see, they have a very brightly colored interior of the mouth. It's this bright red, and then they have the bright red feet too, very showy. And they spend a lot of time vocalizing on the rocks right near the beach. So people encounter this species a lot because it lives and forages right near the shore. And here's a picture of the pigeon guillemot swimming underwater. Now all these species I've shown, the puffins, the murres, rhinoceros auklet, they all propel themselves through the water using their wings. So they essentially fly underwater. I mentioned they have fairly small wings. Well, those are good for flying underwater. If your wings are too big, that makes it a lot tougher. And penguins are the ultimate example of that tendency. They obviously have very small wings and can swim quite well with them. Some more shots of that guillemot flying underwater. Okay, we're going to look at cormorants now. The first species is the pelagic cormorant. They tend to nest on very sheer, rocky cliffs. Okay, you can see they range up and down the west coast here. And they have the thinnest beak of our three cormorant species. You can see that's a very narrow beak. Okay, here's a portrait of that species. It gets the red around on the face and near the beak during the breeding season. And there's a pair on their nest, which is made out of seaweed and guano. Mm-hmm. You had a question?
Well, are these species having as much trouble with the bald eagle as the murres?
Murres are having by far the most trouble, and that's based on their a colonial breeding style, because when an eagle comes, it tends to flush the whole group, or a large number of it. These birds nest singly or in loose colonies, so they're not as disrupted by the eagle. And the eagles don't tend to land where they nest. You see that it's on a really narrow cliff. So the next species of cormorant is disturbed quite a bit more by the eagle, because it nests amongst the murres. That's the branch cormorant we're going to look at next. Okay, they're showing how the pelagic cormorant nests, a loose colony on a very sheer cliff. Okay, actually we're going to look at double-crested cormorant next, which is a very widespread species. They're found inland. There's huge numbers of this species nesting on the Great Lakes. Hey, but take a look at this. They're pretty spectacular looking up close. I think I have a close-up photo. Yep. So look at that. People think cormorants are just black birds, but you get up close, you see that green eye and all the detail in the around the eye. Interior of their mouth is just a stunning blue. Here's one displaying. And they nest in a variety of situations. They'll nest on the ground, in trees, on cliffs, very variable in their nesting habits. And they get those crests just in the summer, for which they're named. Okay. And here's our last species of cormorant, the branch cormorant. You can see that they're nesting up here, as I mentioned earlier, with those common murres. And they'll nest in little clumps in amongst the murres. And they, most of the cormorant species get some sort of wispy white tufts like this during the breeding season. And again, they're pretty spectacular close up. Some bright colors. So this area right here is called the Guler pouch. And you're all familiar with the pouch on a pelican, right? This is the same piece of anatomy. The pelican has a large Guler pouch. The Guler pouch on this guy is this blue color. And cormorants and pelicans are actually closely related. Here's a good example of that type of branch nesting colony, usually on the top of a rock. And they're not jammed in super close like the MERS are, but they are colonial nesters. Mm-hmm. And this photo shows the breeding display at both ends of the cycle. So they go for like, and then they rear it back like you see in the, they get the wings out and start vibrating them. It's quite a show. And there you go, get those wings up. And there's some movement involved here. There's some vibrating and all that. So you quint ahead in May, you can go and try to see this. I recommend it highly. Okay, here we got two display, and the spot where they display is where they're going to build the nest. Okay, so here there's this pair has formed a bond, and they're starting to build their nest here out of, again, seaweed and guano. And you'll see them bringing seaweed into that nest all summer. They just keep replenishing it and fixing it up. All right, we're going to look at the western gull next. Now, this is the species most people call seagull, okay? But it's a large gray-backed gull, and we do see a lot of them here, but western gull is actually the rarest gull in North America, believe it or not. I have some information on their actual populations later. Now, we see tons of them, and one reason for that is they are very conspicuous, and they go in the same areas as people do. So we have a lot of interaction with these gulls, which makes them seem quite common.
Are those the same one you see inland, like in Eugene, or is that a different kind of gull?
Eugene, you mostly see the ring-billed gull.
Okay.
Yep. They're a little bit smaller than this, lighter back, yellow legs. Okay, that's just a painting of the chicks being fed. I guess I was just putting that in there to show off.
Do they have more than one chick?
They have up to four chicks. Yep. This is a related species that we also find on the coast here. This is the glaucous wing gull. Let me go back. You see, this has a very dark back and black wing tips. This next species, that's the glaucous gull, has a much lighter gray on the back and gray wingtips, okay? And both of those are common along here. This one's having a big snack. A lot of times they have trouble swallowing these sea stars and seem to regret it midway through. That doesn't look comfortable to me. They're very kind of spiny too. It's just not good going down. Okay, so this, maybe you can't really see that too well, but there's a couple MERS on the bottom here, and this is what's supposed to happen when a predator comes, is they get together and go with their little pokey beak at the gull. So that's more how they're supposed to respond to predators instead of all flying away. Now the theory on that is that most of these MERS grew up in Oregon without a lot of bald eagles around. And then the population of bald eagles gets much larger, it starts attacking the colonies. They're not used to it. They didn't grow up with eagles. So up in Alaska, where the eagle populations didn't diminish, the MERS up there are more used to it. They don't flush as much. Yeah.
What's the life expectancy of the MERS?
About 20 years.
So
yeah, they're fairly long lived. So, yeah, you know this, clearly there's not much breeding going on now, but there hasn't been much decline in the species population because they are long-lived. So unfortunately in 20 years there will be far fewer MERS than there are now.
Do
I don't think there's any question about that.
Do the gold, different gold types mingle together? Like, say, if you were like over at like, oh, I don't know, the transfer station, and will you see the different kinds of golds together?
Are you talking about co-mingling or mating?
No, just taking advantage of what they feel is a feeding thing.
Absolutely. Yeah. They're very happy to hang out together, and they will even mate with each other. Oh. So that's no big deal at all. Okay, now here is our next species of seabird is also a shorebird, black oyster catcher. Many of you have probably seen this bird in the rocky intertidal, quite loud and conspicuous.
Oh, yeah.
They actually should be called a dark brown mussel sucker. Because in fact, they mostly feed on mussels on the Oregon coast rather than oysters. Here you can see they also range quite widely along the west coast here. Here's a gang of three oyster catchers. They have those pink legs, bright, big, chisel-shaped bills, which they can use to pry limpets off the rocks, things like that. Okay, so the world population for this species is 10,000. But the Oregon population is only around 400. So this is a species of concern for various reasons listed here. It is a small population size. They're restricted to the right immediate coastline. And they live in and nest in areas that are easily disturbed by people. Okay. So that's the reason that there's some concern about the black oyster catcher. Portland Audubon Society does surveys in conjunction with Forest Service each year to monitor this species population. Okay, so now I have more information on the populations of various species. There's still, as I mentioned, there still are many common murres along the coast here. They're still quite highly populated, even with all the disturbance from the eagles. Tufted puffin, fewer than 200. That's not good. Okay, there used to be thousands. Just in the 80s, there were thousands. The population has rapidly declined, and there are no studies on why that is. The species has been petitioned for listing under the Endangered Species Act in the lower 48 states, but that is on hold indefinitely.
Okay. So, excuse me, that's 200 for
the Oregon coast.
Just the Oregon coast.
Yeah. There's probably 500,000 in Alaska. Yeah. Pigeon guillemot at 4,600 is quite common and widespread on the coast. And then we have some information on the different species of cormorants. Okay. Pelagic being the most scarce of those. And that western gull, just 18,000. The number of times you see them, you'd think it would be more than that. And then there's the black oyster catcher, again, at just 400. Okay, here is a species that actually is on the endangered species list, the marbled murrelet. And this part of the coast where you all live is one of their strongholds, actually. They nest in old growth forests, as many of you have heard. They'll nest on a big mossy limb in up to 50 miles inland. The brown pelican doesn't breed in Oregon, but it actually comes up during its non-breeding season, which is our summer. Okay, so these they should be arriving back in the state before too long. They go down to California and Mexico to breed during the winter months, and then come up north in the non-breeding season. And that's a painting I did of that species. This is a bird that is often mistaken for a tufted puffin, okay, because it has this big, brightly colored beak. It's actually a type of sea duck, the surf scoter, and it is quite common right off the coast here near Florence. They feed mostly on shellfish, that's the male, here it is with, and whoops, I almost said it's Old Squaw, which is the old name. Now it's called the long-tailed duck. It's another diving duck species, as is the harlequin duck. You can see these up at, not right in Florence, but you go up to Strawberry Hill is a good place to see them. And they're a spectacular duck, just gorgeous. And they have good taste in where they live, because they like to spend part of the year on the coast and part up in the Cascades. These are the males. And their harlequin refers to their clown-like markings. This is a bird you don't see from shore too often. This is the black-footed albatross. Okay, and they don't breed in Oregon either, but they come here to forage, and it's really an amazing thing. Okay, they breed in the Hawaiian Islands and fly all the way to Oregon just to eat during the breeding season. I think I have a graph of that coming up here, showing some of their foraging routes. So this is a species related to albatross that is quite common off the coast here in winter, and they're often seen washed up on the beach. It's a northern fulmar. You can see in this shot that tube on the nose. The albatross and fulmars have that tube shape on the beak, I should say. There, you got a good look at that. And they expel salty excretions through that tube. Okay. Well, great. Thank you very much. That perfectly,
so,
Dan.
So we have some time for a few questions here, so fire away.
So I was under the impression that cormorants were always native here, and then somebody told me no, they've been introduced from Japan or somewhere. But
That's totally false. They're native. So that settles that.
I noticed that gulls congregate at creek mouths along the coast. Do any of these other species do that for freshwater source at all? Do they need fresh water?
You know, I've seen the gulls doing that a lot, and I haven't seen other species do it really. Occasionally some shorebirds will gather near the gulls, but none of these, the auks or cormorants do that. So. Yeah, that's a good question. Interesting. Yeah, I hadn't thought about that before. Okay.
How do the children who are involved with your workshops find out about you, and where do you collect those kids?
This is these are all on remote Alaskan islands, so there's not much else going on. These are Aleut kids. They're the native kids up on, I typically go to the Pribilof Islands, which are out in the middle of the Bering Sea. I've been there many times, probably over a dozen summers up there. And there's two islands that I've done the camp on the Pribilof Islands. Does that answer your question, or was there more to it than that?
Okay,
good. Yeah.
Just one thing. Milepost 179, which is just past the sea lion caves where the big pullout is.
Yeah.
In the summer, you have all of these people nesting, except the rhinoceros hawklets, which you've already said are down below, but we track the oyster catchers, all of the different cormorants. We see all of them there. So are looking for, come on up.
So that's just a pull-off that you're talking about.
It's a big pull-off. Mm-hmm. You walk over and you look over with your binoculars.
Mm. Okay, so there's the MERS are nesting there, the cormorants?
You will get
the
MERS there occasionally, or they'll be up on by the lighthouse.
Okay, any puffins?
No, there's one puffin that's further down and you can't get to it.
Okay, the only place around here I've seen tufted puffin is at Hasita Head quite a few years ago.
And Bandon.
Oh, sure, down in Bandon. The best place in the state is Haystack Rock at Cannon Beach. and a lot of people are interested in going up there to see them.
But all of the cormorants and all the other birds that you're talking about.
Sounds like a great spot.
Yeah, I mean, you can see the different, by how the nests are built, you know, when you're looking at the stuff. It's really quite interesting.
Huh? I've stopped there a few times, but maybe not during
That's
the right
time. Audubon and the state are doing one of their studies, isn't that it?
There. Studies of which species?
Of the cormorants and the they're the ones that are keeping track of them in that marine reserve. That's the spot where they're counted.
Great. Sounds terrific.
One of the spots.
Okay, good. All right, did we have any other questions?
Yep. A lot of them are having food supply problems. Is that, you know much about that or?
Yeah, that is not studied in Oregon very much. It's amazing how difficult it is to study seabirds in Oregon. And it's actually difficult even up in Alaska where you can actually live basically with them. I've been engaged in some of the studies up there, and there just isn't that type of work going on in Oregon very much. One of the big seabird projects is in the Columbia River, and they've studied the OSU has studied the Caspian terns up there and the double-crested cormorants for many years, but there aren't a lot of intensive long-term studies going on in the state that would be able to determine the extent to which the forage fish are the issue. So, okay.
The number of chicks are young that some of the birds have. The,
sure.
Myrrh has
one,
and same with the puffin.
Yep.
And pigeon guillemot.
I think they can have two. Okay. Yeah. And then cormorants can have four. And black oyster catcher can have four. Up to four, yep. Sometimes less than that, but so it varies based on the species. But I think all the alces, those related to MERS and puffins, they all lay, no, that's not true. Some of them do lay two, but so it does vary based on species. Yep.
People see MERS and penguins. Are they closely related at all, biologically?
They're not related at all. It's a convergent evolution. And one of those panels I was talking about, one of them's going to have a big title on it about MERS. It says, "They're not penguins!" Okay, I already got that title planned.
Is what you're saying.
They're not even related.
On the panels that you're going to put out, how are you going to protect them from the weather? What's the strategy there?
They're fabricated out of a fiberglass material. So they're printed and then it's embedded in fiberglass. And the coastal elements aren't a concern. It's more sunlight that fades them and affects them. So that's the biggest issue is the amount of light hitting them. So, but thank you for asking. Okay, we're good.
So thanks again for coming up. Yeah. It was a very intriguing presentation. I know I learned a lot. Also, I'm going to mention, he does have a website that you can find on the internet. I found it, and so you can learn more about his work there. And thanks again for coming on down.
Sure. Thank you.
All right.